Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Dr. Rahul Gupta, the director of the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, speaks with Dr. Josh Sharfstein about the overdose crisis. They discuss the national drug control strategy, harm reduction, access to addiction treatment, and what's needed to turn the corner. Let's listen.
Dr. Rahul Gupta, thank you so much for joining us on Public Health On Call. It's great to see you. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me. It's great to be with you.
Now, you and I met when you were the West Virginia Commissioner of Health. You've had a very long career in public health, and I think it might be helpful for our listeners just to hear a little bit about you.
Well, I'm a practicing primary care physician, someone who's sort of has not only run a private practice, but also been in academia and then in health policy, both as a local health commissioner in West Virginia, as well as a state health commissioner for two governors, have spent some time at Marsha Dimes. And then for the past year, I've been honored to be in this position of being the director of Office of National Drug Control Policy here at the White House.
Now, you are the first doctor, if I'm not mistaken, in that role.
That's correct.
Why do you think President Biden chose a position this year?
Well, I think it's signaling to the nations that, and not only in the United States, but across the world, that, you know, we need to look at our drug policies in a way that suits today or what's happening, but also looks at the past and looks at both the successes, but also the some of the challenges we've had, because this is the most dynamic drug supply environment. This is the one time where we have over 100,000 deaths a year from drug overdoses and poisoning. So it's important to have someone at the helm who understands both the challenges from an addiction treatment infrastructure, but also the supply side as well.
I mean, you have not only treated patients with addiction, I'm sure you've taken care of people who have lost family members to addiction, or maybe even nearly lost their own lives.
I think that's one of the things that I bring to the table, is the ability to not only understand the patients who need treatment, having been in emergency rooms shift after shift, where I was reversing an overdose nearly every shift for months at a time, but in my office where I've treated so many folks, but also lost some people because of overdose and poisoning. And then some of my patients actually were also incarcerated, arrested for crimes. So have seen the entire system of care work and not work for people often.
So you go from that environment where to the White House, and you're responsible for the nation's drug control strategy. And that isn't a theoretical concept. That's an actual document, which I've read. Tell me about that.
Yeah, so one of the things that Congress did many decades ago is create this Office of National Drug Control Policy at the White House that is intended to create, it does really a couple of things. First, it creates the president's drug control strategy for the nation, meaning that what are the most important things that we need to address is from a policy standpoint, and then have the ability to implement that with the budget tool to work across the $40 billion budget, 19 federal agencies, to be able to provide that direction and guidance so we can implement that strategy in order to reduce illicit drug use as well as its consequences.
So you mentioned the absolutely terrible statistic of more than 100,000 Americans dying every year of overdose. What is the strategy to reduce that number?
Yeah, you know, this is not only it's important piece, but it's heartbreaking every time, because an American passing away every 5 minutes around the clock. So it becomes very important that we have a strategy which is robust, urgent in nature of action, but also data-driven and based in science. When we looked at it, we looked at the largest, biggest drivers of why we're there. A couple of drivers come to mind as we framed the strategy. One was the lack of treatment infrastructure for addiction across our nation, that we need to help people. And the other one was the drug trafficking and its profits. So there's a number of things that the strategy describes, all the way from prevention and adverse childhood experiences and the importance of evidence-based programming in prevention, to the ability to get treatment, recovery support services, harm reduction services, as well as the supply side of drug trafficking and its profits.
I'd like to ask you about one of the priorities you mentioned, which is increasing access to treatment. There are relatively few doctors who can provide effective treatment for opioid use disorder, in part because of all kinds of extra requirements that are placed on them. What is going on to encourage and promote doctors actually providing life-saving care?
I think one of the biggest challenges we've had is these self-inflicted regulatory wounds over the years. And one way to address that is to make sure that no provider has unnecessary barriers and they can provide treatment to the full access to their training. And one of the things we're doing is to make sure we're working with Congress to remove those barriers when it comes to getting people ability to get access to treatment. And that requires removal of some of those barriers in Congress, like the X waiver, the extra regulatory requirements. So we're hopeful that this type of policy change will allow us to have much broader access to treatment for people, no matter where they live, and no matter whether they have insurance or not, they're able to get the access to treatment.
So your message to Congress is get rid of these unnecessary requirements. What's your message as a physician to the medical profession?
I think my message is, let's embrace people who need help when and where they need help. Let's make sure that we're providing them the best evidence-based care, like we do for diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and others, and treat this as a disease. So let's expand our realm of possibility and get people the help. We know that these folks are in our practices all over. We need to make sure that we're providing them the help they need.
So I want to ask you about harm reduction, because there have been some news stories that this year's drug strategy, with you responsible for it, had more about harm reduction than many of the previous ones, if not all. Tell us about how the federal government is thinking about harm reduction right now.
Yeah, I think, Josh, it's a great question, because one of the first things we have to have in a strategy when you think about it is, just like we do in medicine, triage. When we have 100,000 people dying a year, we need to make sure, how can we have the most impactful evidence-based programs to save lives right now as we speak? And one of those is meeting people where they are, making sure that people get naloxone, which is an antidote for opioid overdose, at a time when 4 out of 5 people we're dying is because of a synthetic fentanyl or an opioid overall, which includes synthetic drugs, including fentanyl. But also then student service programs. That means, of course, that using student service programs have demonstrated to not only connect people to care, but meet people where they are, provide them various services, and prevent, obviously, costly sometimes and life-threatening diseases like HIV and hepatitis. And then drug testing, fentanyl drug strips. Reason that's important is because this synthetic fentanyl, illicit fentanyl, is so pervasive in our drug supply. It's important for people to have the opportunity to check their own drug supply. These three components, for the first time in this way as harm reduction, have made into federal policy in the president's administration. And it's really important to understand it, but also why it's happening. It's because we must work with the North Star of saving lives to prevent as many people from dying as possible, and then help people connect to treatment.
We're seeing some places, New York, Rhode Island, consider overdose prevention sites, which are another form of harm reduction that are more common in other countries. Where does that stand right now with respect to the National Drug Control Strategy?
I think we're continuing to look at all the evidence when it comes to addressing and using emerging harm reduction strategies and understand the clinical evidence for it. For a particular issue of overdose prevention sites, I know there's litigation that is ongoing with in court, so we're awaiting those decisions before and not want to get ahead of those decisions before we see where things go.
Got it. One other question about the strategy. I think, and I'm sure you would agree to some extent, that the war on drugs has not been a success, and that the criminalization of drug use has in many ways harmed communities rather than made it harder to get drugs, even let alone reduce the serious consequences. How do you navigate with law enforcement partners, because I know there are a lot of them involved in your office, the history of a failed war on drugs with, you know, their interest or your policy priorities to, as you said, take profits out? Is that the war on drugs by another name? Is it something different that you're trying to do?
So we're working across the arc of criminal justice that starts with, first, if someone is in trouble for mental health or substance use disorder, let's make sure that they get the help they need instead of being incarcerated. Secondly, let's figure out how to get treatment, pretrial diversion, drug courts, and other aspects that will help people. Third, let's get people treatment behind the walls. And that's another aspect, because we know that the amount of people that lose their life right after going out into the community is very high and unacceptable, or there's high levels of recidivism. So there are aspects that law enforcement, you know, I would say suggest that in many ways is so tired of doing the same old thing and having no different results when it comes to domestically incarcerating people. And there are so many evidence that's shown us so many better ways to be able to deal with getting people the help when and where they need it, rather than just pure, simple incarceration.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you about the president's recent announcement on marijuana, which broke with precedent in some important ways. And, you know, went in the direction that you're talking about, trying to reduce the criminalization of drug use itself. Tell me more from your perspective about that.
Well, you know, the president's recent announcement was historic in nature, as you mentioned. And, you know, President Biden has been very clear from day one, which is, you know, people should not be punished for simple use or possession of marijuana. So the announcement does three things. First, it pardons all those in the federal system for convictions for marijuana simple possession or use. Second, it challenges governors to do the same, because the bulk of people are in the state system. And third, it asks the Attorney General of the United States to work with the Health and Human Services Secretary to look at the scheduling, because marijuana remains a class one, a schedule one substance. Now, here's why that's important. First, we know that people who have convictions for simple possession use will have, and pardoning that will allow us now to get those folks the ability to get their life back. Meaning now when you look at housing, when you look at employment, education, loans from federal loans, child welfare benefits, or simple things like serving on having jury duty, it allows people to not have the ding on their you know, on their record and be able to proceed with their life. But another very important part is when it comes to incarceration arrests, there's very big disparity, racial disparity, as opposed to the prevalence of use. While the prevalence of use is same across the country, Black Americans are incarcerated almost four times as much as white Americans. So this also helps us make sure that we are having equity lens through our policies across the nation, which has been a very important part of this administration's approach towards drug policies.
Got it. Now, you have your finger on all these details. You are writing these specific strategies. You're spending your days talking about all kinds of specific policies with different federal agencies. It's a big job, but how do you think strategically about the future? What's realistic to think about what can happen in this country that will start to really turn the corner. I mean, I feel like in the time that I've been working on this, there have been moments where things have gotten better and moments where things have gotten worse, but never the sense of turning the corner. You know, what will that take? What does that look like in the United States?
Yeah, so it's a few things. First, we have to make sure that policies like naloxone distribution, meaning getting the antidote to people who are dying, gets across and in all communities that need it. And it becomes important, as important as having a defibrillator or having a smoke alarm in your home. So because it is so prevalent, so we can begin to save lives. Second will be expanding treatment. Because, you know, today, 5%, just 5% of people, of tens of millions of Americans who need treatment, are able to get treatment for opioid use disorder. Third, it's going to be important for us to work at getting people the help around it. Meaning, when I travel across the country, one of the big and most important people talk about things is housing. Things like why it's important to find that housing and a job in order to get people into recovery. So recovery support services are not where they are. Need to be. And we need to make sure that people have that wraparound services around their life so they can get the support, whether it's transportation, childcare, food security, all those things we often talk about as social determinants of health, but they're really survival determinants of health that allow people to do well. And then one of the more important things also I'll mention is stigma. Because we need to treat addiction as a brain disease. And we've seen this movie before. In fact, about 100 years ago, we used to have cancer. We had such a stigmatized approach to cancer. There were hardly any treatments. We left people literally to die if we ever told them that they had this diagnosis. And today, look, cancer is one of the most funded, well-funded research and development, and we have some of the treatments. But we also have compassion when we approach people who are diagnosed newly with cancer. We have prevention approaches. I don't think we need to take 100 years when it comes to addiction and substance use disorder to get there. But I do think that we need, that was the turning of the corner, which is we need to make sure that we're removing the stigma out of this disease. We're helping people with mental health and substance use disorder survive, but not only survive, but thrive. And one of the ways to get there is all these things possible that I mentioned helps people, but we need to convert them into probable. So the success of anyone and everyone is high at that level. And that's one, and we're starting to see that, some of that. If you look at the month-to-month number of overdose deaths released that comes out of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, we began to see a 35% increase in those deaths at the beginning of the pandemic. That's down to about 6% now. So, from an epidemiological aspect, anything that, you know, it's before it does a U-turn, it's going to have to stabilize. And we're seeing some of those numbers. So my hope is that some of the work that is happening is taking root, like telehealth expansion, ability for people to take medications home and be treated, and increasing access even in rural areas and some of the most underserved communities. But our work's not done, and it's going to take so much more effort and partners across the nation to get there.
Well, I really appreciate your coming and laying this out for us. It's great that there is a physician in that job. And I think you are attacking this challenge, like you're rolling up your sleeves and going into an exam room. So I appreciate your joining us and thank you. Good luck.
Thank you for having me, Josh.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.